This morning. Appreciate the good singing and the fellowship. And now I'm just trusting in the Lord to help us this morning in the message. And I apologize for my voice this morning. I know it's hard to listen to somebody that's kind of got a strain in their voice and all, but I'm trusting in the Lord to help us this morning. And if I have to sing this whole message, I'll sing it. But I'm going to give glory to God today for everything that He's done. I've been laying on my back all week long, coughing and hacking and going on and running fevers and sweating and everything else. But I'm trusting in the Lord today that glory be come from His word. His word will not be returned unto Him void, but it goes out and it does the work that He has it to do. And I'm praying for you today as you listen and for the reading of God's word. Let's stand and turn to the book of Psalms, the first chapter in the book of Psalms, Psalm chapter 1, and I desire your prayer. I want somebody in here to just pray continuously this morning as we preach. Just pray continuously that we'll get through this message, and I know the Lord will be glorified for it. Psalm chapter 1, let's look at the entire chapter. And here the Bible says, "Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and his law doth he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the day of in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish." I'd like to preach for just a few minutes this morning on the subject of how to be a happy Christian. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the reading of your word this morning. Lord, help me now. Lord, anoint my throat. Lord, anoint me to be able to preach for just a little while, God, on this passage of scripture. Lord, may you be glorified. May the folks in here, Lord, this morning receive your word, Lord, into their hearts. And may a mighty work be done. These things we ask in Jesus' holy name. And amen. You can be seated. Well, now, before you think I've apostatized into the Joel Osteen or Robert Schuller way of thinking this morning, I don't want you to be worried about that. We're not talking about these seven steps to how to be happy this morning. But what I'm wanting to show you this morning from God's holy word is how you as a Christian can be happy, how you can be blessed as a blessed man. The Bible speaks of two different types of people in this chapter this morning. It's speaking of a person that is blessed and a person that is cursed. And that's the truth that I want to give this morning. Tonight, Lord willing, I'm hoping to preach on the one that's cursed. But this morning, I want to preach on the one that's blessed, the blessed man. And so as our text starts out this morning using that word, blessed, blessed. Now, I'm not going to bore you to death this morning with Hebrew and Greek definitions, but I do want to give you this one here of the word blessed. This comes from a Hebrew word called esher, and it means happiness. Happiness is what that word means. Now, I searched throughout the Bible trying to find that word as it's used here in our King James Bible, the word blessed, in some form of esher from that Hebrew word of being happy. And I found 94 instances throughout the Bible that that word is used. And most of them, actually, it's kind of split half and half. 45 times in the Old Testament, you're going to find that word used, and 49 in the New. In the New Testament, of those 49, the Lord Jesus uses that word 29 times. 29 times the Lord Jesus wants you to know how you can be blessed or how you can be happy if you want to look at it in that form. He says, "Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful." In other words, what our psalmist is trying to get across to us are the ways that we can be happy. You could phrase it, happy is the man. Now, I'm not trying to rewrite the Bible. That's not how the Lord would have us to do. But the thought behind it is how you can be happy, how you can be blessed of the Lord in your daily walk. Well, when the Bible speaks about a walk, he says, happy is the man, or blessed is the man that walketh. When we hear that word walketh, that is what you think of someone on how they live their lives. I want you to think of this morning of someone that you know. And when you think of them, what is it that you know about them? For example, you may think of someone, maybe somebody that's popular today. Maybe you hear the name Billy Graham. Exactly what do you think when you hear Billy Graham? You think of preacher. You think of revivalist. You think of a man that's preached across all of the world, and probably one of the most famous preachers in all the land. And he has that reputation because that is how he has walked in his life. And so that's the way that he has walketh. And what that is, you walk, that is your reputation. It's what you're known for. A lot of us earn reputations, and sometimes it's good, sometimes it's bad. Throughout school, whether it's good or whether it's right or wrong, in high school, we all earn some type of reputation. And if you're in high school today, as I was back several years ago, I'm not going to count how many that was now. Feels like yesterday, but I know it wasn't. But many of you here this morning are in school. And so as you're in school, you have a certain reputation. You're known as a certain way. I was known as somebody that was very shy, somebody that was very backward or bashful. I was also known as someone that would go and defend somebody if they were being bullied. I had a calling in my life when I was a young man that if I saw somebody being bullied, then I wanted to go and attack the bully. And so I was known for that. I have a reputation for that. Some people might have said I had a reputation for fighting, but I was just trying to make wrongs right. But you may have a reputation. Maybe you have a reputation, as my sister did, as someone who could play the piano. She had a reputation as a fine pianist and singer. My other sister, she graduated, and in her senior year, she was best dressed. And so she had a reputation for being the best dressed. So throughout your life, you're going to have people look at you and the way you walk, the way you walketh, and you're going to be known, and that's your reputation. Well, the Bible here is talking about a man, how he walks, how he's known, how we see him. And we all know people that have certain things in their lives that we know them by. They may be wise, or they may be honest, or they may be dishonest, or they may be a lovely person, or a real mean person, or they may be somebody that's very smart, or someone that's very dumb. But we have these little labels that we have for people because that is how they have walked. The psalmist writes here, "Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly." So to ensure that we're happy, the Bible says if you want to be blessed, if you want to be a blessed man, a happy man, and by the way, that term man is universal in the Bible in most cases, and it means man or women. And so he's talking about anybody. If you want to be blessed, blessed is the man, or blessed is the woman, or blessed is the teenager. Anybody that's trying to walk with the Lord, blessed or happy are you when you do not take counsel from the ungodly. Now, to take counsel from the ungodly means that you're taking their advice. You're looking at someone and what they did or what they say or how they live their life, and you're taking that into your own life. You're taking that advice or that counsel. We all know what a counselor is. That's someone that sits down with you and gives you advice that they want you to follow. And so if you follow that advice, you're following their counsel. The Bible says if you want to be a happy man, a blessed person, then do not take the counsel, the advice, the wisdom of the ungodly. Now you may be saying, well, Pastor Byron, I would never do that. Why would I purposely ever take the advice of somebody that is ungodly? Oh, really? What about when it comes to money matters? To money matters. You know, money in this walk of life means a lot to a lot of people. A lot of people put a lot of stock in money. They live their life based upon how much money they have or how little they have. And that's all they dwell on is money, money, money. And so you can take someone that proclaims to be a Christian, and somebody can come to them, some ungodly person, and they say, you know what? I know how you can save this much money on your income taxes. I know how you can get by with putting down this little indiscrepancy on your income taxes, and you can get back a bigger return. And you may be thinking, well, now, that sounds pretty good. And nobody will ever know because they've been doing it for years. And so you take this counsel, this advice from this ungodly person that tells you to cheat on your income taxes. Well, friends, not only have you sinned against God when you've done something that's dishonest and untrustworthy, you've sinned against him, but you've also been dishonest to our government, which, by the way, when it comes to income taxes, I hate them myself, and I pray that we could abolish income taxes. I hate anything to do with it, but that is the law of the land. And so if you're going to take ungodly counsel to lie, to cheat, to do something to try to gain something from it, the Bible says here you're not going to be a blessed man. You can't expect to be blessed and to be happy as long as you're taking the counsel of the ungodly. You know, the Bible says that the love of money is the root of all evil, not money. Money in itself is nothing. It's just an object. It's a necessity to have to use. For instance, when our lights went off today, did somebody say, "Oh, did they pay the light bill?" So we had to have money to pay that bill. So it is a necessity. But the love of it, the want of it, the desire of it, to always think about it and to long for it and to try to gain more so that you can do more and to have more and to all this, this is when you put your affections on money. And the Bible says that is the root of all evil. And money has a way of influencing people. It has a draw on some folks that they can't resist when the opportunity to get money comes up, whether it be right or wrong, they're going to do it. Perhaps you know someone that has discovered a way that you can lie to your insurance company and suddenly get the benefit out of it. I've had people come to me and say, "Brother Byron," you know, well, they didn't call me Brother Byron. That's just what I call myself. That they say, "Byron, let me tell you what I did. My insurance company was going around the neighborhood after we had a storm, and one of my neighbors got a brand new roof. And all he had to do was report this, and they had a team of surveyors come out, and they just checked off on the thing that it needed a new roof. And so he come around knocking on doors, and all we had to do was let him check on the paper there that we need a new roof. And the insurance company come and put a brand new roof on our house, $3,000 that I didn't have to pay for. And I was needing a new roof for years because mine was falling apart." He said, "You know, that's all you got to do. All these storms that's been coming around, just go and get somebody to tell that you need a new roof, that the weather has caused damage to your roof." And I refuse to do that. But friends, there's a lot of people I know that has took that ungodly counsel. They took that ungodly wisdom from someone in the world, and they did that. Friends, that is a sin. You know, 5 days from now, what's it, April 15th, there'll be people rushing there at midnight to put in those income taxes. How many people today that are Christians have gone to put something on those income taxes? Not true. They put down that they gave so many thousands of dollars to charity because nobody will ever know. The IRS will never check that, or will they? What about business expense reports? You know, in the business I work in, when I go on a business trip, I have to fill out an expense report. We have so much allotted to us for meals. And somebody came to me and said, "You know what? All you got to do is put down just under the maximum amount, and they'll never check it. And you don't have to have a receipt. And if you do that, you can get back a whole lot more money on your expense report when they pay it." And you know, there's a lot of people in this world that do that. Now, if I was to do that, I know that, first of all, I've sinned against God. I've lied. I've done something that it's untruthful, and I'm going to pay for that. That's a sin. But I want you to know, if you expect to be blessed in this life, to be a happy person, you cannot take counsel like that and get by with it. The Bible says you cannot take counsel from the ungodly. Now, these are just a few examples of ungodly counsel. The Bible says, "Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly." Ungodly counsel is more than just the sin of money, the cheating about money matters. If you want to turn with me, look over in the New Testament in the Gospel of Luke. Luke chapter 23, verses 50 through 53. Luke 23. Excuse me. Luke 23, verse 50. And here the Bible says, "And behold, there was a man named Joseph, a counselor. And he was a good man and a just. The same had not consented to the counsel and deed of them. He was of Arimathea, a city of the Jews, who also himself waited for the kingdom of God. This man went unto Pilate and begged the body of Jesus. And he took it down and wrapped it in linen and laid it in a sepulcher that was hewn in stone, wherein never man before was laid." Now this Joseph of Arimathea, probably one of the least known men in the Bible, but always when we read about the crucifixion of Jesus and when they took his body down, we see this man mentioned in the scripture. Did you notice what they called him? The Bible says he was a counselor. He was one that gave advice. Most likely he sat up on the Sanhedrin court, or he sat up on the court in the high priest office, and he was a counselor along with the other men. And so when it came time, when the council got together and they started debating on whether or not they were going to crucify Jesus, and they all sat around and they said, "What? Thank you. What about you, Joseph? What's your opinion about this Jesus? Should we crucify him?" The Bible says here, the same had not consented to the council and deed of them. So Joseph stood up and says, "No, I don't agree with this. I'm not going to take part of this evil thing that you're doing against this man, Jesus." You see, the Bible tells us that he was also a disciple of Jesus. He was one of those secret disciples. But he was there, and the Bible, he'll forever go down in the history of the Bible as being a man that was just and a good man, the Bible says. He did not take the counsel of the ungodly. In other words, he was known by his reputation that he walked, that he proved that he was a good man. And look at verse 51. It said, the same had not consented to the counsel and deed of them. So you see, he had the opportunity to follow ungodly counsel. But yet he said, no, I won't do that. He consented not. The Bible says, secondly, there that to be a happy Christian is to standeth not in the way of sinners. You know, taking advice from the ungodly is one thing. But then you go on the next step, the next progression in this downward spiral the Bible's talking about how you would not be blessed. The next step you would take, not only would you take counsel from an ungodly person, but then it says you will stand along with a sinner. Friends, if you're going to stand along with a sinner, you've got big problems. Not only have you taken their counsel, but now you're standing along with them. You're identifying with the ungodly, with the sinners. To stand along with someone is more deliberate. Sometimes we may take counsel of something and brush it off, or we may take somebody's advice and it was bad advice and we go through it and we live through it and we don't do it again. But when you stand along with somebody in something, that means you're in agreement with them. And so the Bible says if you want to be blessed, you do not stand in the way of sinners. That don't mean that when you see a sinner coming, you jump out in front of them and stand in their way. That's not what the Bible means. What it means is you do not stand along with them. You're not part of them. As a Christian, you're not to be part of the world. Oh, we are in the world, but the Bible says we're not of the world. You see, I'm of another place. When I got saved, my membership moved to heaven. And that's where my membership lies. I may be living in this world for who knows how much longer. We never know. It's appointed unto men once to die. We will all die one day. So we don't know how long we'll be here. But in the meantime, we will be here in the world. And as long as we are, I believe that everybody would like to be a happy person, would you not? Would not everybody in here like to be blessed? How many here can raise your hand and say, I don't want to be blessed, Brother Byron. I don't want to be. I don't want to be happy. I want to remain miserable and sad. I want to remain in bondage. I want to remain in sin. I want to remain downcast. Can anybody in here honestly say, I want to be that way? I believe everybody in here would like to say, Brother Byron, I'd like to be blessed. I'd like to live a life that's pleasing to God. I'd like to live a life of happiness, one that I can look back upon in years from now and say, I lived a good life. I tried my best. I didn't take this ungodly counsel. I didn't stand there with the sinner. Oh, we would all like to be that way. The word sinners is used here indicates those who purposely defy God. They purposely do it. It wasn't an accident. They didn't stumble into sin. It wasn't something that they were forced to be into. They accepted it on their own. They've purposely defied God. They don't have a relationship with the Lord. They've lived their lives dictated by their own lust, their own desires, their own sin. They may appear to be successful to the world, and that's the problem. You see, the world today measures success on a different way than God does. The world today will measure success on a man's bank account. They'll measure your success on the clothes you wear. They'll measure your success on the amount of crowds you can gather. They'll measure your success on your popularity or your fame. That's the way the world measures success. But that's not how God measures success. The Lord measures it in an entirely different way. It's not based upon your popularity or your ability to draw crowds or anything like that, but it's based upon your resemblance to his son, Jesus Christ. That's how Jesus measures you. The world looks upon churches with the same measuring stick. You know, the world today would look at a church such as ours and say, we're a miserable failure. They've got empty pews in there this morning. They've got folks missing. There's things that they don't have there. They don't offer this program or that program. They're a miserable failure, and that's how they measure us. But that's not how God measures the church. Listen to how God measures the church. The Bible says in Ephesians 4:11, the Bible says, and he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man. And listen to this. This is God's measurement. Unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. God measures a church's success upon how closely they identify with his Son, Jesus Christ. That's his measurement of a church. It's not how many pews are filled. It's not how big their building is. It's not if they have a coffee lounge in the lobby. It's not any of those things. It's not based upon having a family life center. It's not based upon having some kind of volleyball team or anything like that. God doesn't say that church is successful because they have all these things. He's saying that church is successful because they look like my Son. Because when I look at them, I see the blood of Jesus applied to their hearts. I see them preaching and teaching the gospel. I see them reaching out to others in the community and trying to help them. I see them trying to reach the world with the gospel. And the God measures our church that way. How do they measure up to my Son Jesus, to his teachings, to his life? And that's how God measures a church. Sadly, a lot of Christians today measure with the world's mentality. They're willing to forsake holiness and virtue and stand in the way of sinners and the sinner's way of thinking. They're willing to trade off, to sacrifice holiness for the world, to sacrifice holiness to take the counsel of the ungodly, to sacrifice holiness and pureness to stand in the way with sinners. They use foul language today. You know, people say, well, you know, I'm under grace, and the Lord understands these things. That's no big deal. I can pop off a word here and there. Really? Really? Oh, the Lord understands if I want to drink socially. Oh, it's just a little bit now and then. Really? Really? Is that your view of God's grace? Is that how much you think of the Lord today? That God doesn't care if I just slip by just a little bit, sin here and there. Oh, it's just a little bit. Doesn't hurt anybody but me. Really? Is that how much you think of God this morning? My friend, if that's you today, that's not what the Bible says, how you'll be blessed or happy. In fact, it says the opposite. It says to be blessed, to be happy, is to not stand with the sinners. I see thirdly here, the Bible goes on another step. This is another spiral downward. First, it's not taking the counsel of the ungodly. Then it's not standing in the way with sinners. But now look at what they've done. The Bible says if you want to be blessed, you don't do this. You do not sit in the seat of the scornful. You see, it goes from walking in the counsel of the ungodly to standing in the way with sinners to then pulling your chair up to the table with the sinners, with the scornful. One thing leads to another, and it's all a downward spiral. To be scornful means to openly mock, to defy, to laugh, to deride the things of God. You show contempt for the Lord Jesus. Usually when you see the word scorn in the Bible used, it's preceded with laughed. Laughed to. I remember the Lord Jesus. He went down to the man's house where his daughter had died. He came to Jesus. He said, my daughter's died. He said, but I believe if you will come, you can help her. You can bring her back. And so the Lord Jesus goes to this man's house, and he walks in the room where the young lady is dead, and there's a room full of people in there. And Jesus says, he says, what's all this going on in here? She's just sleeping. And the Bible says that they laughed at him, that they laughed him to scorn. In other words, they looked at Jesus Christ and they say, you fool. What do you mean she's sleeping? She's dead. And they laughed at the Lord Jesus. And he had to take them out of the room. The Bible says, and when Jesus came into the ruler's house and saw the minstrels and the people making a noise, he said to them, give place, for the maid's not dead, but sleepeth. And it says, and they laughed him to scorn. They had such little respect for the Lord Jesus that they laughed at him. So the Bible says if you want to be blessed, you don't pull your chair up to the table with these that are scornful. You don't take their ungodly advice. You don't stand in there with them as sinners. Another example, when Jesus was hanging on the cross being crucified. You know, we just had Easter recently. And we've preached several messages about the cross and the cruelty of the cross and the blood that was shed and the pain that the Lord endured. But if you want to look there in the Gospel of Matthew 27, I want to show you another form of this scorning that was done to our Lord as he was hanging on the cross. Matthew 27 and verse 38. In Matthew 27 and 38, the Bible says, then were there two thieves crucified with him, one on the right hand and another on the left. And they that passed by reviled him, wagging their heads and saying, thou that destroyest the temple and buildest it in 3 days, save thyself, if thou be the Son of God. Come down from the cross. Verse 41 says, likewise also the chief priest mocking him. In other words, in scornful ways, mocking him with the scribes and elders said, he saved others, himself he cannot save. If he be the King of Israel, let him now come down from the cross, and we will believe him. He trusted in God. Let him deliver him now, if he'll have him. For he said, I am the Son of God. The thieves also, which were crucified with him, cast the same in his teeth. You see what they did to the Lord Jesus? The Bible says they were mocking him. Mocking him. That has the same meaning as the word scorned. They derided him. They made fun of him. They laughed. They thought so little of the Lord Jesus, they laughed and mocked as he was hanging on the cross, suffering, bleeding and dying for our sins. That's how little they thought of him. Yet there's those that are pulling their chair up, sitting at the seat of the scornful today. People that claim to be Christians today that are pulling their chair up to the table. They might as well have their name engraved on the back of their chairs. You ever go to one of those places where they put your name down at the table so you know where to sit? I've been to a few of those. I don't like those kind of things. I don't like people telling me where to sit for one thing, but it's always too fancy and there's not enough food there. You know, if you want to invite me somewhere, take me to a buffet. I don't want to go where my name's on the table. But we got Christians today that might as well go to a place where their name is there with the table of the scornful, and they pull up their chair up beside them because that's how little respect they have for the Lord Jesus Christ. You may say, well, Brother Byron, why do you think that? Look around you today. And you look at the lives of people today that proclaim to be Christians, and you see how they're living, and you see what they think of the Lord Jesus. Friends, if you think so little of him that you're willing to live a life defying him, living in sin, blatantly living in sin against the Lord Jesus, you're pulling your chair up there. You're sitting in the seat of the scornful. My friend, every time you willingly sin against God, you're pulling your chair up to the table with the scorners. That sin that has a grip on you that thinks that you think only affects you. Oh, it doesn't hurt anybody else, Brother Byron. It's just a little sin I like to do. Nobody knows about it. It doesn't matter. But God knows about it. And every time you commit that sin, willingly commit that sin, in the eyes of God, friend, you have pulled your chair up with the scornful. You've taken counsel from the ungodly. You stand in the way of sinners and you sit in the seat of the scornful. You might as well say, I care less about your sacrifice, Jesus. When you hung on the cross and shed your blood for me, for my sin, when you pulled me out of the pits of hell, I could care less about that. So I'm going to go ahead and sin against you. You might as well go out and be truthful and say it, because you're pulling your chair up there with the scornful is what you're doing. You're being seated with them. You look at Lord Jesus, you might as well laugh and mock him like they did at the cross. If you want to be a blessed and happy Christian today, you cannot take the advice of the ungodly, the counsel of the ungodly. You cannot stand in the way of sinners. You cannot sit at the seat with the scornful. So what's our answer to be a happy Christian? Well, it's given to us there in our next text, back in our opening text, Psalms 1, 2, and 3. Psalms 1, 2, and 3. The answer to being a happy Christian is, of course, not doing all those things the Bible just listed out in verse 1. But in verse 2 of Psalms 1, it goes on to say this. It says, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. And in his law doth he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. The psalmist says that our delight is in the law of the Lord. Well, what's that mean? That means if you want to be a happy Christian today, if you want to be a blessed Christian today, then our delight is in the laws of the Lord. You may say, well, I thought the law was done away with. That's not what the Bible's talking about. It's not talking about keeping the old Levitical laws. It's not talking about those kind of laws, the dietary and all that. It's talking about God's commandments, God's holy laws, the ones that God says, thou shalt not do this, thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not murder, thou shalt not lie, all these things. Plus, that's not all. Everybody thinks about the Ten Commandments. The Bible is filled with commandments from the Lord about what not to do and what to do. And as long as we're defying God, as long as we're not doing what he says to do, we're not going to be a blessed person. You will not be blessed. You will not be a happy Christian. When we come to the conclusion that our sin is not the thing that makes us happy, you may think it is. Oh, sin is pleasant there for a season. But I want you to know that sin is what's causing you to be unhappy. That sin is what's dragging you down. The thing that's always back there gnawing at you, it's always dragging you down. It's always having you with a little bit of guilt in your life. The thing that you know that is hindering you, it's the sin that you have against God. The Bible says if you want to be a blessed person, a happy man, a happy woman, a happy teenager, what do you need to do? Well, you don't take counsel of the ungodly. You don't stand in the way with sinners. You don't pull your chair up in the seat of the scornful, but you delight yourself in the law of the Lord. That means you keep his commandments. You be obedient to him. You are a willing vessel for the Lord. You want to obey him. You want to be obedient to him. You want to be, like the Bible says, that tree planted by the water. You know what that is? That's an analogy of a tree that's always receiving nourishment. You know, if you took that tree and put it out in the middle of the desert where there's no water at all, that tree's going to wither and dry up. But the Bible here gives us an analogy of a tree that's planted close to the water, where all the times its roots are going out there and it's receiving nutrients, and that tree is growing, it's getting bigger, it's branching out, the leaves are blossoming, they're turning green, and fruit's coming out of the limbs. And the Bible says, that is a blessed man. That is the man that's been following the counsel of me. That's the man that's been following and obeying my laws, my commandments. The one that's in love with me, not in love with their sin. They defy their sin. They've repented of their sin. They've come to me, and they're living, delighting themselves in the law of God. And that person, that Christian, is that one that you can look at and you can see all that fruit that they're bearing. You can see. The Bible says, Jesus said, you will know them by their fruit. And what he means is that Christian that's delighting himself in the law of God, that's doing the things that he asks of you, is being obedient in this walk of life. That person is a blessed person. They're a happy Christian, and they're producing much fruit. Wouldn't you much rather be a fruit producer than one of these withered limbs? Wouldn't you much rather be that tree that's planted by the water, that's always receiving the nutrients, the blessings, the mercy, the grace of God, instead of that one that's always defying him, always sinning against him, always doing all the things you know you shouldn't do, and being miserable about it? Friends, the Bible is very clear on what we need to do today to be a blessed and happy Christian. We must delight ourselves in the law of the Lord. I want to ask them to come and get the invitation song this morning. You know, this world today, their view of happiness is when you have everything that your heart desires. That's the world's view of happiness. Brother Byron, if I've got money in my pocket, if all my bills are paid, if I'm in good health, this and that, you know, if my family's doing all right, then I'm happy. That may get you satisfied. That may make you feel good. That's not true happiness. True happiness is when you know, without a shadow of a doubt, your heart is clear and right before God. That you've kept his commandments. You're not harboring sin in your life. You're not habitually sinning against God, defying his laws. True happiness comes from serving the Lord. That's where true happiness comes from. And as they sing this song, I want everybody to stand in here. And if you've been straying away from God and you need to get close to Him, you need to get back into the counsel of His counsel, would you come to the altar and pray this morning?